J.M. Frey. I'm here at historic Glastonbury Abbey and at the gravesite of King Arthur and Queen Guinevere to read a little bit of my story, The Once and Nowish King, which can be found in When the Hero Comes Home from Dragonlance Press. The first thing that Arthur Pendragon, the once and future, well, nowish king, did upon his rebirth into the world at the moment of Albion's greatest need was to open his shriveled red mouth and squall out, "Oh, hell no," which startled his mother quite badly, you'll understand, as she had just put him to her breast for his first little feeding. The second thing that Arthur Pendragon, the once and nowish king, did upon his rebirth into the world at the moment of Albion's greatest need was to consume his body weight in breast milk, after which he soiled his nappy, burped quite dramatically, and took a wee bit of a nap. Getting born was hard work. Arthur was doing his damnedest to stay asleep and not let the little hunger cramps and haunting sense that he wasn't bundled up enough wake him every few hours. It was uncomfortable and odd, but he was determined. He was absolutely capable of letting his new parents get a full night's sleep, and perhaps to do the same himself. Having always been a man of strong will, he managed to do just that. Somewhere in the middle of all of it, Arthur also managed to dream. He was standing on a battlefield, and he knew Mordred was behind him, but he couldn't turn around fast enough. He hadn't been fast enough in real life, either. And then there was Guinevere's big liquid eyes, and Lancelot's guilty frown, and something Merlin whispered in his ear about coming back one day, about the future of the kingdom resting upon his soul, about being called forth again like the pagan gods from their barrows. And then there was a shrill screaming, the likes of which Arthur hadn't heard since one of his horses had fallen into a pit dug in the road by his enemies, and snapped its foreleg. He killed the stallion for pity. It wasn't until someone's big warm hands were on his back and he felt himself tucked protectively against his father's soft, sloping chest that he realized he was awake, and the shrill, plaintive sounds were coming from him. He, the once and nowish king, was sobbing hysterically. "Shh, buddy," his father said and jogged him a few times, bumping him closer to wakefulness. "You're safe, you're safe. Daddy's here." Arthur snuffled closer and let himself cry out the rest of his residual fear, because what his father said was true. He was safe here, at least for now. There were no dragons to slay, no traitors to roust, no scheming and no politics to navigate, and no affair to untangle. There was only Arthur, and his father's warm assurance, the sound of his mother's soft snores in the other room, and the woolly sheep spinning in a calm, slow circle, blown by the cool breeze of the nighttime air slipping past the gap in the endearingly crooked windowsill. "Daddy," Arthur said, curling chubby fists into the collar of the man's sleep shirt. He didn't feel ridiculous at all for using such a juvenile term. King Uther would have boxed young Arthur's ears for daring to utter it, but here, now, it felt right. "I'm Arthur," he breathed. "I know," the man said, and dropped a soft, dry kiss on his son's cheek. "That is what we put on the birth certificate." The open affection of the gesture shocked Arthur into more tears, though these ones were soft, quiet.